डॉक्टर मेघा, एम आई ऑडिबल? हेलो डॉक्टर मेघा, एम आई ऑडिबल?
हेलो डॉक्टर भावेश, गुड इवनिंग. यस, यू आर ऑडिबल.
ओके, सो आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू दिस वेबिनार. एंड टुडे आवर स्पीकर इज डॉक्टर मेघा नटराज. शी इज एमपीटी कार्डियोपल्मोनरी फिजियोथेरेपी. एंड दिस वेबिनार इज अ 1 आवर वेबिनार. एंड आई होप यू ऑल विल एंजॉय दिस वेबिनार एंड लर्न मेनी थिंग्स फ्रॉम आवर स्पीकर. ओवर टू यू डॉक्टर नटराज.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bhavesh, and thank you very much to Dr. Jeffin. Very good evening, and I welcome all the attendees to today's webinar, which is on health promotion of elderly individuals. So now, without wasting much time, I will quickly start sharing my slide. Just let me know if my slide is visible to all of you. Can somebody just unmute and let me know if the slide is visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Okay, fine. So yes, very good evening, everyone. And glad to have you all today here on a Sunday evening, especially. So without wasting much time, we'll start with today's webinar. The topic is health promotion for elderly individuals. So as we all know that the World Health Organization defines health to be a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely an absence of disease or infirmity. I'm sure this definition of health is by this time so familiar to all of us as healthcare professionals, right? But there is something more that we must look at when it comes to health, which is the component of promoting health. So what exactly is health promotion? Health promotion is the process of enabling people to increase control over and to improve their health. It goes beyond a focus on the individual's behavior, but towards larger objectives like considering the social and the environmental factors which do have an effect on an individual's health. And because of the combination of not just an personal level intervention, there is a interaction of social and the environmental level. This concept of health promotion is now being recognized as an essential element in the subject of healthcare. So now trying to understand how this has an impact on the health. So investment and action in health promotion has been found to have a marked impact on the various determinants of health. So these determinants include the social, economic development, physical environment, an individual person's characteristics, their behavior, an individual's educational status, their social support, the accessibility to various healthcare services, and also the gender aspect. So now, why this becomes important to understand what impacts health is because now all of us as a physiotherapist, we deal with patients on a day-to-day basis, right? And we do see so many differences when we treat, you know, one person versus the other patient. So these differences are all impacted by so many determinants. And that is why having an overview of these determinants can help all of us get a better perspective about our patients and largely plan the treatment protocols. So now let's quickly understand from where did this concept actually evolve. So health promotion, this concept started somewhere in 1920s and in the 1960s. So roughly for 40 years, this concept has been present. And initially, this concept took responsibility in terms of just providing, you know, basic healthcare services for people in the rural and in the urban setups. And later, it started implementation towards the community developmental schemes. And this entire concept was actually put forth in Ottawa for a larger domain, which was towards a public health movement. And from there, this entire concept of health promotion has now spread across the globe. So now, understanding what is this need for health promotion. Okay, so before I actually dive into this topic, on a very quick understanding, okay, see, we all come across, you know, elderly patients, and I'm sure that all of us in our home, okay, we have at least one, you know, elderly member that can be your auntie, your uncle, your granny, your grandpa, or some cases, even your parents. So elderly people are, they form that very, you know, important subset in this entire patient population. So this concept of health promotion becomes really, really important for addressing this particular group especially. So now understanding why this entire need for health promotion started. So as we all know, we have all, you know, scaled up in terms of urbanization. We live in very high-tech societies. Our lifestyle has changed in a very big way. And this has also, you know, led to more number of people adopting a very comfortable lifestyle in terms of being more sedentary. So as we get on to being more sedentary, we are actually risking ourselves to a lot of, you know, chronic health problems. And as we see statistically, the number of older people across India and also globally is on the rise. And as we all know that as of today, India would probably be one of the nations where, you know, the number of people who are in the youth population is much to be delivered to the. So now keeping this as an overview, let's actually start into understanding this topic of health promotion. So as we saw that there is urbanization, so there is a big change in the way we lead our lives. We have all become very sedentary. You know, so this actually shifts us in scale of, you know, how we are utilizing our body in a big way. And in some parts of the globe, poverty is also another very important, you know, determining factor. So with all this in mind, you know, governments both nationally and globally, comprising of the government sectors and also the various, you know, healthcare providers and the policy makers, they have all, you know, chalked down a few strategies which can be very, very important towards health promotion. And when we see this entire list of, you know, what are those topics which have been, you know, enlisted to be the most important, exercise and physical activity always stands on the highest level in this entire hierarchy, followed by nutrition, followed by sleep, rest, and periodical medical, you know, checkups with the physician, psychosocial well-being, having an overall spiritual well-being, and understanding, you know, health risk behaviors or the use of medications. So with all this, now we'll quickly try to understand what are the levels of health promotion, okay? So as you all remember, in the very second slide when we started what was health promotion, we saw that health promotion does not concern with only, you know, the patient. It's not just about me. It is about the environment that I live, the society that I live. Everyone comes together when health has to be promoted. So according to the Society of Public Health in 1993, four levels of health promotion have been stated. So the first one is at the environment level, the second one is social level, followed by organizational, and ultimately at an individual level. So let's try to now understand the, you know, environmental level. So when we speak about environment, okay, what actually comprises our environment? The home that we live, you know, the surroundings, our work area, you know, areas which are going to influence us. So this can be just walking down the street or, you know, standing at a railway station, standing in the airport. All of these areas become your environmental areas. Now, understanding social areas. Okay, so social areas are more like, you know, groups of people coming together. So these can be people with similar health problems, or these can be people, you know, across various age groups. So you can have a small community which focus on, you know, cleanliness programs. You can have communities which focus on creating awareness. So simple examples like, you know, the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, that can be like the one of the most simplest examples to take. You also have other examples coming up these days with so many health promotion and, you know, awareness-based schemes. So anything that involves a group of people will fall under the domain of social structure. Then comes at an organizational level. So maybe at an organizational level, we can consider, you know, it can be a college, it can be a hospital, it can be a group of hospitals. So now let's take an example of all of us who are attending this webinar. we are all a part of, you know, ABC Hospital. So as a part of this ABC Hospital, we do certain activities that are initiating the patients, or it is initiating the caregivers to take part in, you know, activities that are going to promote their health. So these are activities that you can, you know, strategize at a single small level, which is at an organizational level that you can do. Now coming down to the individual level. So individual level is about me. It is about you as an individual. It is about your patient, how they understand their health, what they think, you know, determines health, and how do they see their health today? And what is their understanding about their own health, maybe 5 years from today, maybe 10 years from today. So for example, if you are having a patient and for some reason, you need to take a simple history, like a smoking history of your patient. So you cannot directly ask your patient, do you smoke? That might become a very obvious question. You can probably ask your patient that, you know, I read in your history that you have mentioned about smoking. So would it be fine for you to discuss something about your smoking habit with me? So something like this will, you know, kind of create that bond between you and your patient. So your patient may kind of speak up about their own health habit. So this thing comes under the model called as the health belief model. So what you do is you try to make somebody aware about their health so that they start, you know, doing things which will help them get healthier. If not today, but over the period of time. Okay. So now, with all of this understanding as to what was health and how health promotion is important, what are the various levels in which health needs to be promoted? We will actually dive into the topic and try to understand old people, okay? So old people to all of us is anyone who's, you know, more than or equal to 65 years. But if you largely look at the classification of old people, so there are two, you know, differences. In India, at an Indian level, we consider anybody who is 60 years and above to be old. So there are three actually levels. So you have somebody called as young olds, you have somebody called as middle old adults, and then you have somebody who are old old adults. So usually anybody in the young old category will be, you know, somewhere between 60, 65 years. Somebody in the category of middle old would be 65 to 70, 75 years. And anybody who's above 75 years will come under the category of old adults. Okay. So this bifurcation will be slightly different if you are looking at the global population, which defines old adults to be 65 and above. So in India, we consider 60 and above, but in foreign countries, we consider 65 years and above. So we all know that as people age, you know, their body is aging, multiple systems in their body is going to age. So automatically, if at a younger age, they were functioning at 100%, with age, maybe that functioning may come down to 80% or 70%, 60, 50. And in many cases, it might be so low that somebody may require to become totally dependent or extremely bedridden. So with this in mind, we will try to understand the benefits of physical activity. So as a physiotherapist, we all, you know, with pride, we speak about physical activity, right? Because we understand that physical activity is such an important factor for our patients. It helps in slowing down the physiological changes with related to age, because these age-related changes has an impact on the exercise capacity of a person. There are changes in terms of body composition. People, you know, become more sedentary. They are more confined to their houses. So automatically the body weight is increasing. The deposition of fat in their body is changing. It is on the rise. And many a times patients become, you know, very psychologically, you know, they go on to things like depression and anxiety. Their overall cognitive functioning is also declining as they start aging. And all this contributes to their already aged body. So with so many things happening around them, the risk of a physical disability is on the rise, and that of mental functioning and that of how the body is reacting to these changes is also declining. And because of this, how somebody lives in their old age is largely impacted. So basically, longevity of life is taken at stake. So now quickly just trying to understand what are all the various body systems that start aging, okay? So one of the commonest systems that is going to age is your musculoskeletal system. So when you compare somebody who is 30 years versus somebody who is, you know, 65 years, what are those obvious changes that you look for, you know, in a person in terms of their muscles? Number one, the structure of the muscle is going to change, right? The cross-sectional area, the bulk of the muscle is going to change. As they age, the muscles are going to become more fragile. You know, the cross-sectional area is going to become slightly lesser. The muscle fiber numbers are going to decrease. The patient may have a big shift in terms of, you know, their type 1 fibers versus their type 2 fibers. So because of all these things, the muscles start looking very, very lean. So if you're going to be checking a patient, you know, their bone and their muscle, the muscle will just form like a single layer around the bone. So there won't be any structure to the muscle. This is in terms of the musculoskeletal system. Then coming in terms of the cardiovascular system. Okay, so cardiovascular system, the main thing what happens is that the heart. Okay, heart is a very, very important cardiac, you know, muscle. And with age, automatically, even this muscle is going to undergo fatigue. It's going to undergo a lot of structural changes. So what is happening? The cardiac muscle, you know, the pumping of the ventricles is all going to change. Maybe the ventricles will become more weak. They will be atrophied. So what happens if this is going to be the structure of a healthy heart of a patient? With age, that ventricle will become really, you know, it will shrink. So when the ventricle is going to shrink, automatically the pumping is going to get reduced. So because of that, the blood which is circulating in the entire body is going to get changed. Now this will directly have an effect on the respiratory system of the patient. Okay, so as a young adult, you know, all of us, we can take a nice deep breath, we can run, we can jog, we don't feel tired, right? But if you expect the same thing for somebody who is 60 plus years to do, what is the first obvious thing that you will see in terms of their respiration? You will see that they have shortness of breath, you know, they pause, they wait, they, you know, they slow down, they gasp for their breath. So why does that happen? That happens because the heart is unable to pump. The pumped blood is unable to, you know, get oxygenated. It's unable to reach the various organ systems. So that is one of the most important, you know, change which occurs in terms of the respiratory system. Now, coming down to understanding the neurological system. So neurologically, with age, definitely the number of neurons are going to, you know, change. The synaptic junctions are all going to, you may not have the same number of synaptic connections when you compare a young adult versus a very old patient. So that is the reason patients will complain of, you know, a memory loss. They may not be able to recall something that they have done, you know, 1 week before, or for that matter, even 1 day before or 1 hour before. And I'm sure all of you have heard of the term dementia, right? These days, you know, these neurological conditions like dementia, Alzheimer's, have become so common even in the Indian setup, because so many old people are living alone, and because they are living alone, you know, psychologically they are impacted. So that is going to be a very big challenge as a physiotherapist for all of us to, you know, deal with these patients. So this is a very important neurological change. Next comes the somatosensory system. So somatosensory system is basically the understanding of all the senses. So with age, what happens? The neurological system is getting declined. So overall, all the sensory parameters are also changing. Number one thing, patients start complaining of, you know, a visual deficit. Many patients would have undergone a cataract. They would have retinopathy. They would have glaucoma or some other eye-related surgery. Or some of them may even go blind. They may have, you know, differences in terms of the vision. They can't see something that is far away. There can be far-sightedness or, you know, short-sightedness. These are, again, important aspects. Then many of them may have hearing deficits. So imagine dealing with an elderly patient in your own clinic and the patient has a hearing deficit. So how would you talk to the patient? How would you instruct the patient? So these physiological changes are so important, and they become a very big barrier while we try to, you know, rehabilitate a patient. And with all this in mind, the most important system that gets affected is definitely the overall health. So patients become sedentary, they are all confined to their house, confined to their bed. So is chakar mein, what starts to happen? Their body weight is continuously rising. So body mein fat badhta hai, muscle kam ho jata hai, bone ki density kam hone lagti hai, they become very weak. And that is the reason the old people are always at a risk of, you know, losing out their balance. They start walking, they fall down, they don't fall once, they fall two, three times. I'm sure you all would have come across, you know, such patients who tell you a history, especially patients with a total hip replacement and knee replacement. They usually complain of a history of, you know, fall that results in a hip fracture. Some of them will have a fall bilaterally. So right hip is also gone, left hip is also gone. So these are all common problems. So these are only at a systemic level. Okay. There is also involvement of the endocrine system, you know, the metabolic system. So with age, you know, there is a big risk of diabetes. There is a big risk of hypertension, thyroid problem, parathyroid problems. So these hormonal changes because of this entire endocrine system, even that is going to affect not one body system, but it is going to affect the muscle, the heart, the respiration, neurologically. So as you can see, everything in this, you know, in this entire chart is interconnected. So one system goes down, that will have an effect on the other. And this vicious cycle is always going to continue in a elderly person. So this slide again talks about the same things which I spoke. So there is going to be a change in terms of the overall physical capacity, you know, the functional capacity of the patient. So that will result in a very big mismatch. So the body is demanding a lot, but the body is also unable to meet that demand. Okay. So when we try to, you know, teach exercises to patients with all of these age categories and with all of these problems, there will be different responses that occur, you know, in their body at multiple, you know, systemic levels. So the very acute response to exercise in such an old patient would be at a neurological level, there would be a big change in terms of the muscle fibers which are there. So when we start exercising, there is a big change in their muscle. The muscle is moving, right? So the muscle is getting recruited. So automatically the muscles cross-sectional area, the muscle, for example, if the biceps was really weak, it had become absolutely fragile. So with some upper body exercises, the bulk of the biceps will start getting enhanced. And because of the bulk, the patient will have more power to do activities which involve the upper extremity of the body. Then coming in terms of the cardiovascular system. So when the heart is pumping better, the lungs are, you know, oxygenating the blood to the whole body, the patient will be able to carry out day-to-day activities. They can walk. They don't feel fatigued. They don't feel out of breath. Dyspnea is not there. Then coming down to, you know, the deposition of lactate. Usually what happens is with being sedentary, there is such a big mismatch in terms of, you know, these metabolic waste products like lactate. So when lactate starts accumulating in all these muscles, even that will start making the patient very, very weak. So in such cases, you know, pushing your patients to start some amount of exercise is always going to help. Okay, so this is again just a very repetition of the various adaptations to exercise. So now we'll just try to look at, you know, how can we do an exercise testing for these older patients. Okay, so I think for those of you who had attended my previous, you know, talk, which was on tele rehab for COVID, some very similar points I might be discussing today in today's talk also. So, you know, can any of you, you know, unmute and just tell me that when you are seeing, you know, an older patient, probably if you're assessing an older patient, what are the challenges you face as a therapist if you have to, you know, test this patient? Okay. So let's keep this little more interactive. Anybody who's attending, you can unmute and just share your, you know, experiences and, you know, difficulties. What are the things that you face as a trouble when you're trying to test somebody who is old, some old patient? Come on, anyone. Anyone can unmute. We'll just try to make this a little more interactive. Yes, Mohammed, anything you would like to share?
Ma'am, basically, if we deal with the dementia people, we would be dealing with their cooperating members also, like family members. Either we would be unaware about what going on about them.
Correct. So as you're saying now, if this is a dementia patient, so there is a challenge, right? It's not always easy to you know, do even a small testing in these patients. Correct. So at a clinical level also, we face this challenge, right? Thanks, Mama. Thank you. So I'm sure that all of you, you know, face this at some point in time. So as Mohammed very nicely he spoke about dementia, it's Alzheimer's, so many other conditions, they come into the way of, you know, handling these patients. And that is why having a very good caregiver support system in the house. So trying to understand whether the patients stay alone or whether the patients are going to stay, you know, with a family member or they stay with their spouses. These things become very, very important for us, not only to assist, but also to get the correct amount of, you know, information from the patients. So that is why exercise testing becomes very important. It is challenging, but yet we have to come up with some, you know, quick, simple strategies. So let's talk about the health screening methods, okay? So I'm sure you all would have heard of, you know, the physical activity readiness questionnaire. That's called the PARQ questionnaire. So these are, you know, simple tools which are already available through which you can actually check whether an old person, is he really willing to, you know, make some change in his day-to-day lifestyle. You can also screen them for any, you know, underlying risk factors. So you can use the AHA or the ACSM's risk screening, you know, proforma. So you can identify whether they fall under the low risk or whether they have a moderate risk or whether they have a high risk. So to very, you know, quickly make you people understand this, the low risk is anybody who doesn't have any underlying health condition. They are absolutely fit. Just that they are old and that's the only thing. Moderate risk would be somebody who already has some underlying health condition. For example, they could have had some cardiac related problem and they are on some medicines. So if you have to make such a patient start exercising, it would always be better to have, you know, the patient's doctor also in the loop so that the medicines and your therapy don't, you know, interfere with each other, but ultimately it is going to benefit the patient. So such a patient will come under the moderate risk category. Now you have the third category, who's a high risk. So who exactly would be a high risk? See, somebody who's extremely, you know, bedridden, they are on many, many medicines, they are on an oxygen support, and they are extremely deconditioned. Such a patient will come under the category of a high risk. So this patient will require a lot of monitoring by you as a therapist and also your interaction with the doctor. So you have to really work hand in hand with the doctor. So you can do this health screening and check their level of risk. You can then identify how ready they are to do an exercise. Okay. Then the other important factor would be to check certain baseline parameters. So in terms of, you know, their blood pressure, what was their, you know, random blood sugar. You can check for their, you know, their BP, if at all any ECG recording was done. You can check for heart rate, pulse rate, you know, all these regular things that we do as a part of the assessment can all be checked as a part of the baseline assessment. And now, you know, with regard to especially now with this COVID time and so many old people confined to the house, never miss out on checking the oxygen saturation of the patients, okay? Then you go for doing a functional assessment where you check certain aspects, which I will talk in detail a little later. And then you can go for certain specific testing. Now, for example, you have a very, you know, a sports person. So you have somebody who was 65-year-old male who was into sports. So probably that gentleman was into, you know, tennis, either long tennis. So that patient wants to go back to that activity. So he is an athlete. So you can do certain specific times of, you know, testing for this patient. Once you think they have become more functionally fit and now they require a very sports specific or a more of an athletic specific training, you can do that for older people as well. Okay. So now, quickly talking about the functional fitness testing. See, with age, okay, a lot of changes are happening as we saw in the previous slide. So many multiple body systems are getting involved. And one of the main system that gets involved is definitely the musculoskeletal system. So when you talk about the bone or the muscle, there is a lot of stiffening of the bone. The bones become hard. They get osteoporotic. So all these changes will indirectly have an effect on the overall health of the patient. So flexibility is a very important factor which will be compromised. So doing a very simple test, like, you know, in terms of a functional flexibility test, you can just ask the patient to sit down and just do a back scratch test. So you can just ask them to, you know, try to touch their upper back or try to touch the lower back. So this will tell you how able they are, you know, in terms of the flexibility. Then you can do another test, which is the chair sit and reach test. So this is nothing but it will tell you the flexibility of the spine and also of the lower extremity. So you can have the patient sit down on the chair and, you know, they can hold their hands like this and slide their hand against their thigh and towards the length of their entire feet. So with this, you will get a clear picture of how their spine is bending. Are they able to bend? Is there some tightness in the back or is there a tightness in the hamstrings? Or are their quadriceps very weak? So you will get some rough idea about the overall flexibility of the patient through these functional tests. Now, this was for flexibility. You can also do a functional strength test. Okay. See, if somebody is going to be, 60 plus years, it is not very correct for us to, ask them to do certain strenuous activities like a push-up. Now, if somebody was 30 years, you can tell them, chalo, do me a push-up and show me how well you can do a push-up. So you can check these things. But in older people, there are a lot of challenges. So you can go for some modified techniques. So instead of an actual push-up on the floor, you can probably, ask them to do a wall push-up, something very simple as a wall push-up. So all the patient has to do is just stand against the wall, placing their hands, and they just have to move their torso in front and push themselves behind. Right. So with this also, you can get a fair idea as to how is their upper extremity strength. Then to check, especially for the lower extremity, there is some external sound. Can you please unmute?
Dr. Megha, please unmute yourself.
Hello, can I continue?
Yes,
thank you. So talking about the lower extremity, for the entire lower extremity, what you can do is you can train your patient for a 30-second chair stand test, also called as the sit to stand test. This is a very nice functional test that you can do. So this will check the entire strength of the lower extremity of the patient. So what you can do, you can ask the patient to sit on a comfortable sturdy chair. That chair can be, next to a sturdy surface like the wall, etc. And with the feet placed down, you can ask the patient to just come and sit towards the edge of the chair. They can either cross their hands or keep their hands in front. And all they have to do is just stand up and sit down. So you will be timing your patients for 30 seconds. So in 30 seconds, you will get to know how well the patient is able to do. Okay, so now, for example, if somebody is very, very deconditioned now, especially with this COVID time, many old people have ended up getting COVID. They have become very deconditioned. So even in 30 seconds, getting like 8 attempts to stand and sit is also a big challenge. And this is a challenge I have also seen in my patients. So for 30 seconds also, when you ask the patient to stand and sit down, you will see so many variations in their movements. Okay, somebody may not, listen to your instruction. They may probably want a chair support. So they may take the chair support. They may push themselves very slowly. So even getting 8 attempts is a very tough thing. Now, this was for the lower extremity. You can also check for the arm curl strength. So this can be done with any small weight. So you can use a weight cuff. You can use a small dumbbell. The dumbbell can be weighed in kgs or in pounds. No problem. You can just do a dumbbell curl. Okay. And you can see how many curls are possible. So usually anything which is, more than 11 is considered a good sign of a arm curl. It's a good indication. Anything less than 11 is considered to be not so, functionally strong enough in terms of the upper extremity. Okay. Now, apart from just the strength of the upper limb and the lower limb, another important, aspect is the balance. So we know as they are going to age, their bone density is going to change. And many of our old patients, they also have a vitamin D deficiency. So anytime in your clinical practice, okay, if you come across a patient who is diabetic and who is hypertensive and they do show some amount of, balance issues, always check with their physician if the patient has a, vitamin D deficiency, because even that can in a very big way affect the balance of the patient. So now again, for balance assessment, there are so many tests that you can do, but some again feasible test, effective test and simple test will include something like the timed up and go test. So the patient sits on the chair, you keep a cone which is at a good 3 meter distance. You time the patient and ask them, as the beat goes, they have to get up from their chair, walk, take a turn against the cone, come back and sit down. And as the therapist, we are going to time these patients. Okay. So for anybody who is, you know, 60 years and above, you can definitely do the timed up and go test. And any cutoff value, which is, you know, more than 9, like if less than 9 seconds they are coming back and sitting, it means that their health is good, their balance is not so compromised. However, if these patients are, you know, crossing 9 seconds or 10 seconds, it definitely indicates that there is somewhere some, you know, balance compromise is happening. So some other system in their body is, you know, overworking. So you have to do exclusive assessments for these patients. Then you can also go for specific assessments like the single leg stance. So in single leg stance, that is a beautiful test where you come to know when the patient is standing, how well they are able to take their entire body's weight on a single leg. And in this test only, you can also see their entire pelvis, whether there is a drop, you know, whether Trendelenburg sign is going to be positive. So even these things you can check. And then you also have the reach test. So simple activities, you can make the patient stand and, you know, ask them to come forward, reach against a target. So that will tell you whether, you know, the reach test is possible. So you can do that in the forward direction, in the backward direction and in the lateral directions. Then you can also use certain tools like the Berg balance scale. So I'm sure you all have seen the Berg balance, you know, questionnaire. It comes with, I think, 16 questions and each question will have a task and you can, you know, score your patient according to how they perform each task. So you can use such tools also. Now, apart from this, balance and the coordination, they will go hand in hand in these old patients. So you also have to check equilibrium versus the non-equilibrium test. So I'm sure at an undergrad level, you all have come across these tests. So I'm not really, you know, repeating any of these tests now. But you can definitely use these alternatives and make it more tailor-made for your patient in specific. Okay. Then you can also check for the functional endurance. Okay. So under the category of functional, what we saw was functional flexibility. Then we saw functional strength. And now we are seeing the functional endurance. So when you say endurance, see, endurance is the ability to do a particular task for a prolonged period of time. Meaning, if now I'm going to ask you all to just stand up and continuously, you know, do a spot marching in your place while you're standing for good 2 minutes. So what does this activity do? It is making you do the same activity repeatedly for 2 minutes. So in this 2 minutes time, I'm checking what is the endurance of your lower limb and the entire fitness component of your body. So similar test, you can definitely do it for your older patients in terms of a 2 minute step test. You can also go for a 2 minutes walk test. You can also do a 6 minute walk test. So these are all very nice functional tests which will check the endurance. Okay. So there are cutoff values which are given, which is available in all the scientific papers. So for those of you who are interested, you can definitely go back and read this in a little more detail. So we saw the functional aspect of the patient. Now we are going to more specific training. So when you talk about specific training, you have to categorize it little more. So specific training will comprise of the adiposity factor, you know, the body composition. So you can check the body composition using various methods. So simple height, weight and calculating the BMI with the Quetelet's index, that is also a common thing. You can also have certain high-tech, you know, equipments in your clinic, something like a body impedance analyzer. So what does this device do? It will enable you to, you know, check the overall fat content of the patient, subcutaneous fat. You can check the visceral fat. You can check the skeletal muscle mass. So there are these devices like the BIA. Different machines are there, different brands are there. Some machines are cheap, some machines are going to be costly. So based on what meets your requirement, you can definitely check these components also. And I will highly recommend, you know, all of you in your clinical practice to definitely check these components because you get to understand a lot about the patient. Many a times just seeing the patient, you may not know something, but objectively, when you check these aspects on the machine, you know, when you get a certain value, that will add more meaning to your therapy. So you can start therapy and at baseline, you can check all of this. Now, for example, you are treating somebody who who's, let's take an example of a 70 year old auntie, okay, 70 year old female. So she has come to your clinic for your rehab and she is very, very bedridden and weak. So when you make her stand on, you know, this body impedance analyzer, you will be able to see how her skeletal muscle mass is, what is the percentage, what is the percentage of fat. And when you put this patient on a resistance training program for good 2 months or 3 months, at the end of the 3 months, you can again, you know, ask the patient to stand on this machine and the machine will calculate it based on the resistance that it gets against all of these body tissues. So you can see a big difference ke pehle kaisa tha aur ab kaisa hai. So that will help you to objectively quantify. So even tomorrow, if you have to, you know, discuss with that particular patient's family physician, if you have to talk to that doctor, you can be more objective in telling them instead of just saying, ke, yes, I'm giving this, this thing. And aisa, you know, like before she was able to, you know, she was not able to walk. Now she's able to walk, but you can quantify it by saying that initial assessment of this patient gave this value in terms of its quadriceps assessment. Now, after good amount of therapy, the quadriceps strength has come to this. And that is objectively, I have checked it using, you know, maybe the timed up and go test, or I have checked it using the sit to stand test. So you can quantify these things by using all these specific tests. Then if you have maybe a high-tech setup where you can, you know, train the patient on the treadmill or on the cycle ergometer, you can definitely do that. But again, over here, you have to first do a detailed screening of the patient. That is which I spoke about earlier in terms of, you know, low risk, moderate risk and a high risk. So the moment you identify the patient is coming under the high risk category, I would strictly suggest don't put the patient on a treadmill, don't put the patient on a cycle ergometer. Rather, go for this functional assessment. You can just do a 6-minute walk test and give a exercise prescription. Or now if your patient falls under the category of, you know, kind of stable patient and you think they will be able to walk on the treadmill, in such a case, you can put your patient on a treadmill protocol. So how you can check them on the treadmill? You can do tests like the Bruce protocol. You can do a modified Bruce protocol. You can do the Norton treadmill protocol. So there are a lot of protocols which are described in, you know, in our textbooks. You can refer to any textbook which is on sports science, like ACSM or, you know, Vivian Hayward's beautiful textbooks. They speak about all of these protocols, but you have to correctly choose what to give for your patient. Okay. Now, another example is, just think that you have a very obese patient who's come to your clinic, okay? This obese patient is anywhere 68-year-old male, and he complains of, you know, breathlessness. He's very osteoporotic. He has a lot of body weight problems, all of this. So imagine if this patient, you're going to put him on the treadmill, you may be actually, you know, putting more load on the patient's knees and ankle because of his body weight and plus because of putting him on the treadmill. So in such a case, you should always go for an alternate protocol, which can be a cycle protocol. So in cycle protocol, what happens? The patient is just sitting on a cycle and they are going to do that cycle and you are testing them through various cycle protocols. So you have the YMCA protocol, you have the Astrand rhyming cycle protocols. So you can just read these protocols and see which one to use for your patients and which patient should be given a cycle. So now in this patient who has such a knee problem and an ankle problem, cycle is a very, you know, good advantage because you're not putting a direct load. The knee joint is not so much loaded because there is no closed circuit, right? It is more of an open-ended circuit. So you can automatically, you know, choose these based on your understanding of the patient and also what the patient wants. See, many a times the patient may not be comfortable with cycle. Imagine having an old lady come into your clinic, she's in sari. You cannot expect that patient to sit on the cycle and do cycling, right? She will prefer something which is more functional in terms of walking or in terms of brisk walking. So choose your protocols and testing based on what the patient requires and what you think is scientifically correct for your patient. Okay. So now this is, again, you have various other intermittent protocols. So these are just same instructions, which I've already spoken about. Okay. And now coming down to, while you're going to do these exercise, you know, testing on these elderly patients, you also have to monitor them for various signs and symptoms. You need to know how physically exerted they are. So for these, what you can do, you can teach your patient something called as the rate of perceived exertion, that is called as RPE. So you can have this scale printed in, you know, Hindi, in Marathi, in English, and you can always explain to your patient that now I will be making you do this particular activity. And while you do this activity, I would like to know how strained you feel. So if you are my patient and I'm asking you to do, you know, continuous 2 minutes of spot marching, and after you finish that spot marching, I want to ask you how tired you are. So first I will make you read the scale and make you understand what exactly you will feel. So once you do that, you know, 2 minutes of spot marching, then you will probably tell me, okay, madam, I feel very exhausted. Okay, I feel very out of breath. So you can ask the patient, how intense was this? And they would probably tell you, I know on a scale of 0 to 10, I feel it was 7 out of 10. So you know that 7 out of 10 was so strenuous to this patient. So when the patient also understand what made them feel more, you know, stressed, they will be able to automatically shift that to something which is more convenient to them. So this kind of a monitoring in terms of, you know, using METS, that is the metabolic equivalence, or using RPE, or using the heart rate, or the targeted heart rate, you can use all these things to help the patient identify what is normal to them, what is slightly strenuous to them, and what is very, very strenuous to them. So once the patient understands, okay, if I walk at this speed, I am comfortable, but if I walk a little more faster, I think I'm going out of breath. So they will be able to, you know, switch their speed. So even when you train them to do a walking, they will probably understand, acha, if I walk faster than this, I am becoming out of breath. I should be more careful and not walk this fast and become tired. So these things the patients will start understanding when you teach them how to do a self-monitoring of their level of exertion or their, you know, the intensity of that particular activity on their body. Then you must also, you know, help the patients identify when they are supposed to stop that particular activity. Now, many a times what happens, I'll tell you some of the common examples that I usually see. Now, with this COVID, so many of these old patients who ended up getting COVID, they became very, very deconditioned. So even a simple activity like, you know, teaching the patient an incentive spirometer, maybe 2-3 attempts and your patient is extremely tired. So as a therapist, you should quickly identify how their facial expression is changing. Have they started sweating? Has their skin, you know, started to look a little more pale? These are in terms of the physical appearance. Now, when you're making the patient walk on the treadmill, somebody may complain of a calf pain. Somebody may say, I feel some discomfort, just stop the test. So these are the criteria which will make you immediately stop the test. And, you know, you should pay attention to what symptoms your patient has reported. So test termination criteria, whether it is a young patient or whether it is an old patient, becomes extremely important as a therapist. So never, you know, miss out on identifying these things. Now that you have checked your patient at baseline for all these aspects, and now you have decided, okay, I will start giving a proper exercise prescription. But before you even give the prescription, first try to, you know, understand how ready your patient is to do an exercise. So the example that I gave initially, if that old lady was uncomfortable in a cycle, so even though she lives in a society where her building has a gym and the gym has all these equipments, do you think that lady would be comfortable to sit in her gym, in her own building, and do that cycling? She will feel very uncomfortable. So as the first step, what we must do is we must always ask these elderly patients, or for that matter, any of our patients, what is it that they prefer? Okay, some patients may tell you that, you know, they are into sports or they are into swimming. So you can definitely give them an exercise prescription which is targeting an activity that they prefer. Now, at an individual level, I don't like to jog. Okay, so if you as a therapist tell me that, Megha, we want you to jog every day for 30 minutes, you know, I would never do that activity. Instead, if you told me, Megha, I would like to know what you like to do. So I would tell you that, you know, I like skipping. I like to, you know, do brisk walking. I would like to do something like yoga. So you are getting a clear picture as to what I like. And based on what I like, you can give me a very, you know, a customized, a tailor-made program, which I will definitely stick to do. Because what will happen, you will teach the patient and maybe you are visiting the patient at home. Sometimes if the patient is supposed to do that at home and see you after a month's time, in that 1 month, you will see no progress. And these old patients usually become very, you know, disinterested. So to keep them interested in an activity, you have to first identify ke unko kya pasand hai. So always make sure that you get in mind ke what your patient wants to do, because only then you will also get a very good success rate in terms of your patient adhering to your particular therapy. Okay, so first after you check that, so that is the first thing. Now in second thing, what you can do is you can start, you know, giving the patient some kind of a काउंसलिंग. नाउ दिस काउंसलिंग शुड नॉट बी लाइक यू नो यू आर टेलिंग द पेशेंट कि आपको ये नहीं करना है, ये करना है, ये तो बिल्कुल नहीं करना है. नॉट दीज थिंग्स. दिस विल बिकम टू डायरेक्ट एंड मे बी यू नो द पेशेंट मे बिकम काइंड ऑफ अफ्रेड. दे मे नॉट रियली ओपन अप टू यू. सो ऑलवेज वॉट यू कैन डू, आस्क देम ओपन एंडेड क्वेश्चन सो दैट दे विल गिव यू मोर डिटेल्स, एंड इन दोज डिटेल्स विल लाई यू नो ऑल दिस की इंग्रीडियंट्स फॉर यू टू डिजाइन द थेरेपी. So you can probably ask them things that they like in terms of the activities. You can probably, you know, ask them questions like, when was the last time you felt that, you know, you were very, very active in your life? So if the patient was currently 70 years, they would tell you, madam, when I was, you know, 50 years old, when I was 55 years old, I was so active. I used to play with all my, you know, colleagues in the office. We used to play cricket. Then you can ask them, so why you were 50, 55 years, when you were so active, how did it make you feel about your own health? So the patient would say something, you know, like, I felt very healthy, I felt very confident. Then you can ask them, okay, what is stopping you from doing that activity today? Then the patient may tell you some more relevant information like, no, now I don't stay with my family, you know, I stay away or I stay alone. My spouse has just died. I have a lot of other responsibilities, or I have financial commitments and financial responsibilities. So I'm caught up in all this. I'm not able to focus on my health. So understanding, when you ask more open questions, you're getting more, you know, reasons to, you know, design better protocol for your patient, because the patient is sharing such an in-depth understanding of their day-to-day life with you. So with all this, what do you understand? You understand the four levels of health promotion at an individual level, you understand at a societal level, at a family level, at an organizational level, and also largely the environment level. So all these things, they come together when you have to promote health for anybody, whether they are elderly or whether they are young. Okay, so make sure you know, start asking your patients the right questions so that your therapy becomes better. Now, apart from this motivational, you know, interviewing or, you know, kind of a good healthy discussion with your patient, you can also try to use a very beautiful strategy of behavioral theories. So that strategy is actually called as the trans-theoretical model. So for any of you who are interested in this model, I highly recommend you to just go Google this, or, you know, check this on Google Scholar, check it on PubMed. Just try to read a little more on, you know, what is trans-theoretical model. So this model is a very beautifully designed concept where we try to understand the behavior of a person towards their own health. So it talks about five stages. Okay, so there is pre-contemplation, contemplation, preparation, action, and maintenance. Now, I'll just give you a small example so you can understand it better. So imagine you're all having a patient in your clinic, and you just want to know whether that patient, you know, really likes being active or not. So you have asked your patient, okay, have you ever been active before? And your patient tells you, no, doctor, I don't believe, okay, in all these exercise and all. कुछ फायदा नहीं होता है, बस वक्त की बर्बादी है. यू विल हैव पेशेंट्स हु विल गिव यू सच आंसर्स. सो यू विल बी एबल टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस पेशेंट इज इन द प्री कंटेम्पलेशन स्टेज वेयर इन ही इज नॉट एट ऑल गिविंग अ थॉट अबाउट यू नो एक्सरसाइज. ही इज लीस्ट इंटरेस्टेड. ही थिंक्स दिस इज अ वेस्ट ऑफ हिज टाइम. सो दैट इज द प्री कंटेम्पलेशन स्टेज. कंटेम्पलेशन स्टेज इज द पेशेंट मे पॉसिबली टेल यू कि हाँ डॉक्टर, पहले मैं एक्टिव रहा करता था, अब वो वक्त नहीं मिलता तो बस मुझे करना नहीं है. सो यू अंडरस्टैंड दैट दिस पेशेंट वैल्यूज हिज हेल्थ, बट देर इज समथिंग दैट इज स्टॉपिंग हिम फ्रॉम बीइंग हेल्दी. सो सच अ पेशेंट, इफ यू प्रोबेबली यू नो इंटरव्यू हिम अ लिटिल मोर, इफ यू काइंड ऑफ मोटिवेट हिम अ लिटिल मोर, ही विल बी एबल टू अडैप्ट टू हेल्दियर यू नो हैबिट्स इन द फ्यू मंथ्स अहेड. Then comes the preparation phase. So in preparation phase, the person may tell you, okay, doctor, I do some things once in a while. So you know that this patient knows something about health. They know something about being active, and somewhere being active earlier or being active as of today has given them some health benefits. So as of today, kabhi kabhi they shift to do it. For example, the patient may tell you ki haan main kabhi kabhi you know hafte mein 2 din walking kar leta hu ya hafte mein 2-3 din main jogging kar leta hu. So you know that they have started to prepare their body towards a change. Then you have something called as an action stage. So action stage is when the patient knows their health status. They know that being active or being physically, you know, active can make them much more healthier than what they are today. And they are also doing something towards their own health. So they can be into yoga. They can be into any form of an activity, a sports-based activity or walking, jogging, running, swimming, something they are already doing. So when a patient is in this stage, na, you don't have to put more effort on that patient. You know that ye to pakka kar hi lenge. Aapne jo inko sikhaya, this patient will definitely stick to what you're teaching him and they will do it even if you're not monitoring this patient. And ultimately comes the last stage, which is the maintenance phase. So this maintenance phase patients are going to be somebody who are pro, who are superheroes of their own health. They will do everything that you ask them to do, ekdam time to time. And they will come to you and tell you, okay, yeah, I was feeling this earlier and today I'm able to do this much better. I'm still doing everything that you have asked me to do, doctor. So these are the various stages every patient will, you know, go through. So make sure that you definitely use the trans, you know, theoretical model in your day-to-day practice and in your clinical practice. You will see a very big difference in how your patients, you know, perceive their own health. Because unless they don't value their health, they're not going to give you back anything in return. So your therapy ka time waste ho jayega, they will also not get any benefit and they may ultimately become, you know, kind of disinterested. So use these concepts like, you know, targeting motivation of the patient, understanding their activity interests and using the trans-theoretical model. So behavior theory is very interesting for any of you who like psychology. Please go and, you know, read a little more about this and definitely start using it in your day-to-day practice. So once you have understood how your patient is, you know, perceiving that exercise, then you can design a very nice, you know, exercise protocol. So starting with a nice warm-up of 5 minutes for the patient, which can be targeting all the major muscle groups of the body. So based on whether your patient is, you know, functionally active or they are kind of intermediately active, you can do these warm-up exercises in sitting position, in standing position. After the warm-up, you can make the patient do, you know, simple aerobic-based activities. They can go for a walk. They can do cycling. They can do, you know, spot marching or spot jogging. Then they can stop. They can do some simple resistance or strength training exercises for their upper limbs, for their lower limbs. Once that is done, they can do simple stretching activities for all the major muscle groups, followed by a cool-down phase. And ultimately, that entire exercise protocol will be starting correctly with a warm-up and ending correctly with a cool-down. Now, make sure that warm-up and cool-down actually happens in sequence because old patients, number one, they will forget. So if you're going to teach them like 15, 20 exercises, 100% guarantee they will hardly remember 5 exercises or maximum 10 exercises. So make sure you design activities in such a way that multiple muscle groups are getting involved and at the same time, the overall, you know, health benefit is also achieved for these participants. Okay, now I think we are nearing 1 hour, so I will just try to speed up a little, okay? So, so then you can now design these exercises based on how your patient is able to do. So it can be a very light intensity activity. It can be slightly moderate intensity or moderate to vigorous intensity. So if you have to design your patient with any of this, first teach your patient how they should understand what intensity for them is. So a simple method is the rate of perceived exertion. So you can use the BOG scale or you can use the modified BOG scale. Very simple tools. The patient has to just grade themselves on a scale of 0 to 10 or on a scale of 6 to 20 if it is the original BOG scale. Okay. Now, talking about the aerobic exercise. So when you're designing these exercises in particular, make sure you're following the FIT principle. Okay, so frequency, intensity, time, and the type of the activity. So here, type of the activity was aerobic. So the activities can be walking, swimming, cycling, jogging. Now, how many minutes in a day they are supposed to do that activity, that you can time it. So you can target, you know, the patient should be able to do at least 150 minutes of that particular activity over an entire week, which means they can do 30-30 minutes on 5 days of the week. So frequency would become 5 days. That is if it is moderate intensity. If it is, however, vigorous or moderate to vigorous, then you can reduce the number of days that they do it. And probably because the intensity is now increasing, you can reduce the frequency. So you have to nicely match the frequency with the intensity. And if it is going to be your resistance-based exercises, then you have to target the repetition versus the number of sets. So initially, what I would recommend is don't make your patient do everything on the first day. Okay, the second day, the patient will tell you, nahi, nahi, mujhe ye doctor se nahi karna hai koi bhi exercise. Don't let that happen. On the first 2-3 days, keep it so simple that your patient should feel ke, ha, itna hi hai. Oh, this is so easy. Gradually do the progression. So maybe in the first day, you targeted just 5 exercises. But those 5 exercises covered the upper limb, it covered the lower limbs, it covered the back, it covered the, you know, the abdominal muscles, it covered the low back muscles, the pelvic muscles. So you're covering everything with simple 5 to 7 exercises, which are easy to remember and also easy to perform. Then you can automatically, you know, if you're increasing the sets, then you can reduce the repetitions, or you can keep the sets less and work on more repetitions, however you think your patient is comfortable. So you can make these alterations in your FIT principle. Then comes flexibility. So never miss out on flexibility, because ultimately the muscle has to be, you know, very well stretched so that there are less chances of injuries in later activities. Then coming to very focused balance-based training. So based on whether your patient actually has a balance deficit or they don't have a balance deficit, what I would recommend is always teach at least 1 to 2 exercise which are balance oriented, so that, you know, the overall effect of being old with the risk of falling down and having more, you know, hospitalization. So that comes down in a big way when balance is taken into consideration. So never miss out on these balance exercises. And there are no specific recommendations for balance. So you are free to choose what is best for your patient. You can, you know, make it interesting by having only balance some days. Some days you can keep balance versus coordination. If the patient is more of a sports-based adult, okay, if the patient has been involved into some sports earlier, you can incorporate some kind of an agility-based training along with that balance. So it will become fun, challenging, and yet very progressive. So now with all of this, you know, the entire overview of how you should make your elderly individuals exercise, how you should test them, how you should prescribe to them, the general recommendations include covering all the domains. So you must cover functional aspect, you must cover the flexibility aspect, the strength aspect, the balance aspect, warm up, cool down. Everything has to be covered so that injury prevention is 100% maintained and it is prevented. Now, after finishing all this, it is also important to understand certain, you know, special considerations. So what are these? Now, some of the patients are very deconditioned. They are extremely bedridden. For example, they can have now in this case with COVID. So these patients are going to have a very, very bad health status. And because of being so deconditioned, they will be fragile. And many of them will start showing signs of sarcopenia, that is a lot of muscle wasting. Some of them will be very, very intolerant to even day-to-day activities. So all these are again your special considerations. So in such cases, don't stick to a very, you know, essay that don't go by the actual checklist. Do the necessary modification based on what your patient will be able to do and what is right for the patient. Another important thing you have to consider is that many of these patients always have a heart problem. They always have a breathing problem. Diabetes will be there in almost every other patient that you see. Hypertension will be there in most of your patients. So keep sure and keep, you know, keep yourself aware that these things must not come in the way of their existing condition. So make sure that your patients are, you know, having their medicines on time. After, you know, they should have their breakfast. They should have their medicine. Then there should be a good 1 to 1.5 hours of time. Then you teach them the exercises so that their blood glucose is not dropping. This is in terms of patients who are diabetic or hypertensive. Now you will also come across patients who are having Parkinson's. They are another subset of patients who are very largely dependent on medication. So you have to time these patients based on the time when their, you know, when their medicine has been taken. Because Parkinson's patients will always have an on and off phase, right? So make sure that you are intervening them only when the drug is acting at its right state, so that the patient is more better off to do it. Sometimes when their drug effect will be low, the patient will be very drowsy, they'll be very lethargic, they may not do your things. So these are all the special considerations to keep in mind. Another important thing is when it is a supervised versus when it is a very, you know, home-based program. As far as possible in your older patients, try to keep it as a supervised program, because what happens is with a supervised program for your old patients, there is a constant feedback. So when there is a feedback, though, your patients will develop that sense of trust and they will want to do a little more, though they are tired, like they won't lose their confidence. When it is a home-based program, what is one of the challenges is that sometimes they may give you reasons for not being able to do, or maybe their caregiver, their family member, their grandchild or their spouse, their son, daughter, maybe people are not around them, so they're afraid to do it. So imagine if you have told your patient to do a simple sit to stand, you know, exercise, but for some reason they are afraid of their balance going, maybe this patient will not move from their chair only. So whatever you have taught them is going to go down the drain. So in such cases, as far as possible for old patients, definitely go for a supervised training program. Okay. Then you have to keep in mind their medications, which I already told you. Make sure that all the precautions are taken care of. The patients, especially these old patients, they should not be, you know, exercising in a very hot environment. Make sure that their room, whichever is their room at the house or in the clinic, it is very comfortable for these patients, so that there is no excessive sweating or there is no, you know, completely loss of sweating. All this should not happen, because there will be a big fluctuation in terms of their hemodynamic parameters. So suddenly the sugar will drop, suddenly the BP will become low, and the patient may just collapse in your clinic. So these can all be challenges for old people. And, you know, as a matter of simple fact, for all of you as a physiotherapist, one thing which I will 100% recommend is get yourself trained at least in basic life support. So you can check the American Heart Association's website and find your, you know, nearest training center. Definitely be trained in basic life support. See, advanced life support may not help everyone, especially if you are not working in ICUs, you know, regularly. Advanced is not required, but basic life support to definitely seek ke rakho, so that tomorrow if something goes wrong with your patient, you will never be blamed, because you will have a card which is, you know, giving you the authority of being a health provider. So you are equipped enough, you're trained enough to understand when health can go wrong for your patient, and you will do what is required to save that patient. So these things are very, very important when you're dealing with especially an elderly adult. Okay. So make sure you are trained in basic life support. Now, what we saw all this time were just the, you know, the exercise prescription in general for an old patient. Now we are going to look at certain specific conditions which are so common for older adults. The first common, you know, problem is osteoporosis. Osteoporosis is one such condition in these older people which affects not only the men but also women. It affects anybody who is, you know, 40, 50 years and above. Why? The main important thing is because there is a big change in the density of the bone. The bone mineral density gets altered. So your bones become a little more fragile. They become weak. Weight bearing gets altered, and that provokes your body to, you know, develop fractures. Fractures will become common. Your balance is going to go. There is vitamin deficiency. Apart from this, there are changes even in your endocrine system, mainly the kidney. The kidney, which is a very important organ to maintain, you know, the adequate amount of bone health. When the kidney gets altered, the bone health will also get altered in a very, very big way. So make sure that all of this is also taken into account when you're dealing with somebody who's osteoporotic, because these patients, they definitely come under one of the very high risk category of patients, because there are all possible deficits in this group. Okay. So when you're going to do an exercise testing for this particular patients, just make sure that you're, you know, keeping in mind all the contraindications for these patients. So when you know that, you know, too much weight bearing is going to be a problem, So kind of go for modification. So always choose, you know, protocols which will help the patient. Like I told you earlier, if treadmill doesn't work, go for cycle protocol. So make these modifications based on how your patient is able to do. Okay. Then coming down to, okay, so this is just continuation. You will find all of these, you know, written material on ACSM's 11th edition, or read any of the ACSM editions. You will find this. Now, another common health condition is arthritis. So now arthritis is of various categories in old people. Some of them will have osteoarthritis. So that is again very common. Knee pain will be there. There will be a change. There will be a loss of the cartilage. The meniscal problems are all going to be there in osteoarthritic patients. So naturally, excessive weight bearing is a big no. But still, you have to keep the patient active. So you have to choose the right amount of exercises and how it has to be done. Next category of patients are those with the rheumatoid arthritis. Now, this rheumatoid arthritis patients will always complain of swelling, you know, pain in all their small joints, especially their wrist and their ankle. So automatically, if the hands are painful and you're going to tell the patient to, you know, hold the treadmill and work, don't you think you're going to strain all their, you know, their metatarsals and all their small bones of the hands? So this is again not going to work. So in such cases, you have to plan your therapy very, very, you know, adequately. So if there is arthritis, if there is osteo or rheumatoid arthritis, special considerations would be to target pain. Pain management in terms of medicines, what the doctor is giving, and also certain therapeutic, physiotherapeutic interventions that you can do to manage pain. Maybe, wax, paraffin wax bath can help some of the patients. Some of them may find icing to be useful. So you have to choose what works for your patient, because the pain has to come down. If pain is there, the patient will not do. That will result in stiffness. And because of that, the patient will refrain from anything that you're trying to, you know, tell them. So make sure these things are taken into account. Okay. Now, another important condition that we will see is hypertension. So now in these hypertension patients, one of the main problems is that when you're going to teach them any exercise, many a times, you know, they will start holding their breath and they will do that Valsalva maneuver. So what happens with Valsalva maneuver is that it is just going to cause lot of, you know, pressure on their peripheral circulation. So their systemic peripheral circulation, when that resistance will increase, automatically there will be a big rise in their blood pressure. So even that should be avoided. So as a first instruction for these patients, you have to tell them that, see, don't hold your breath, do only what is comfortable to you. And maybe during your exercise sessions, you should always, you know, encourage them to count loudly, to count, give the counts. For example, if they are doing any squatting activity. So as they squat and as they hold that squat position, you can probably ask them to count 1, 2, 3 loudly so that you are aware they are not holding their breath. Okay. So these little things will go a very long way in managing your patients. Another important condition is the peripheral vascular disease. Now, this peripheral vascular disease is such a thing. What happens is the vessels in the lower limb of the patients, they usually get calcified. So especially in old patients, what happens? So many body changes, so many metabolic changes. There is a lot of calcium deposition. So imagine if this is your blood vessel, okay, this is the blood vessel, and there is so much calcium being deposited in this vessel because of extreme calcification. So automatically blood flow through that particular blood vessel is going to get altered, and your patient will start complaining of, you know, some vague calf pain. They may have pain in their, you know, thighs, they may have pain in their calf or in their ankle. Some of them can have swelling. So in all these cases, no, the patients will complain of something called as a claudication pain. So you must definitely identify what exactly is the causative factor. So you can do a very simple test that is called as the ankle brachial index. It's a very easy test. You can ask your patient to lie down in supine, take their blood pressure reading of their upper extremity. Then same side ka lower extremity, you can take the blood pressure of their lower limb. So you can place the cuff, you can use a manual BP machine, or you can use the, you know, the handheld sphygmomanometer. So in that case, the cuff will be tied somewhere at the calf area. So you will get the systolic blood pressure of both the arm and also of, that is of the brachium, and you will also get the systolic blood pressure of the ankle. And what you have to do in ankle brachial index, you will divide that ratio. So systolic BP of the ankle will get divided by systolic BP of the brachium. So you will get a value. Now, if the value is going to be 1 more than one, it means that there is some amount of a vascular disease involved. If it is going to be less than one, it means that it's not so much. So there is a cutoff range of, you know, 0.8 up till 1.3 is the normative range of ABI. So anything deviating on the lesser side or on the higher side indicates that that particular vessel, that particular vascular structure is affected in that particular patient. Again, in such patients, you will have to target your therapy very, very slow. You cannot expect them to run on the treadmill. You cannot ask them to do anything where the calf is going to be, you know, pumping, you know, very fast, because that will give rise to calf pain. So in such cases, choose simple tests like the functional test, which is the 6-minute walk test or a 2-minute test. Okay. Now, just the last part of this webinar, talking about these older athletes. Now, as I spoke to you earlier, older athletes in India, you may not find so many old people who are actually into sports. But this is something very common in the Western society, because their people have a very different notion of their health. So if you're an elderly patient, is somebody who has been a national level swimmer, so this patient, even despite being old, definitely wants to go back to swimming. So maybe he has an upper limb weakness, or maybe he has a lower extremity weakness. So you have to first target those components which are functional. And once you think now functionally they are able to do it, then you have to go into sports specific training. So a swimmer must get back to swimming. Somebody who plays tennis must get back to tennis. So you always have to plan your therapy in such a way. Okay. So with this, today's webinar from my side comes to a concluding session. So just make sure that all your elderly patients, you know, they don't feel upset about being old, but rather they should rejoice their health despite being old, because they have to be active though they are old. So as a therapist, make sure you always motivate them, you encourage them. And, you know, as often, if you can gather these people in groups. So for example, if you are, an MPT in neuro, so, and if you treat like many patients with Parkinson's, you have all these Parkinson's patients, you know, come together on certain days of the month. Maybe you can have the Parkinson's patients, all of them meet up in your clinic on, you know, the fourth Sunday of every month. So you can have certain group activities. So every patient with the same problem sees somebody else having the similar problem. So they also form a nice group amongst themselves. So these activities will, you know, create that very good peer bond, and they will start, you know, exchanging numbers with each other. They will start encouraging each other. So these are all activities we can all, you know, push our patients to, so that they will still be healthy despite being old. So with this, today's webinar, I would like to conclude it. And these are some of the references that I have used. You can always read articles and scientific papers which are published. You are free to read whatever, you know, material you get. And if you find something relevant, make sure you can, you know, share it with all of us as well. So maybe in upcoming webinars, we can also discuss any of these, you know, reference materials that you people have found out. So with this, if you have any questions, we can now take a few questions if we are not late. Over to you, Dr. Bhavish. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Megha. Yes, we can take few questions. If anyone has question, they can either put that question in chat or they can raise hand so I can unmute them. Dr. Megha, there is one question in chat.
Okay, can you please read it for me?
Yes.
I'll just try to check it. One second. Yeah, I see there is a question by Prachi, right?
Yeah, there is one more from Muhammad.
Okay. Yes. One second. See, what would be... Okay, I'll first go with the first question which has come by Muhammad. What would be the physiotherapy intervention for neurological geriatric patient? Yes, Muhammad, thanks for this question. See, as I have been speaking in this webinar, when it's a neurological patient, you not only have, the overall health of this patient as one of the challenge, but the biggest challenge is the cognitive status of your patient. So you have to first target this neurological component. You need to know how cognitively stable your patient is. So you can use any tool like, you know, a mini mental state examination. You can first try to find out how your patient is able to, you know, understand what you're trying to tell them. because if they are not in a position to understand or, you know, comprehend and tell you the answers for the questions you're asking them, I think therapy will get affected in a very big way. So if that is the case, the first thing is definitely check what is your neurological status of your patient. So that will become the most important thing. In terms of interventions, see, since I'm not from a neuro background, what I would suggest is that you can first spend some time in getting to know the patient. At least the initial, you know, 1 to 2 sessions of your therapy should be more about getting to know the patient. So how you can do that is by asking them certain open-ended questions. Like I gave a few examples during this webinar. You can ask them, you know, questions related to their previous, you know, health status. Like when they were a little more younger. So if somebody was 70 today, how they were when they were 50, at that time, what they were able to do. So even these simple things can tell you a lot about how much they remember, because that memory is again very important. So that is going to be one thing. And once you think the patient is now cognitively, you know, quite stable, then you can probably start teaching them small and then probably progress over the time. And if the patient definitely has, you know, conditions like dementia or Alzheimer's or Parkinson's, I think you have to, you know, definitely manage these patients very well in terms of their medications, so that medication and your therapy has to be managed at the right time. So as a therapist, you have to take that charge for your patient. And you can probably, you know, encourage your patients for simple activities like reading or, you know, talking out. Because what happens is many a times patients with age, they will also have a lot of changes, you know, in their oromotor areas. So there might be weakness of their, you know, the muscles of the mouth, their tongue, all these areas. So automatically speech becomes compromised in many of these patients. So even when you try to ask them questions, they wouldn't be in a right, you know, health status to tell you what is happening. So if you think these neurological patients have these problems, so you always take into loop even a speech therapist or an occupational therapist who can definitely do something in terms of, you know, these aspects also. And still, if you feel you're unable to, you know, get the best out of the patient, 100% encourage the patient for any kind of a, you know, training from a clinical psychologist. That is something I will highly recommend. Because once this is taken into account, especially when cognitive part is taken into account, where only when the cognitive status is good, you will be able to teach them. Now, otherwise, you can, you know, make your therapy in the form of an educational video. But just imagine you have taught your patient like 5 to 10 exercises. You are sending them all the videos to do. And the patient's, you know, family member is giving them those videos on the laptop. But the patient is just not understanding anything. So that will become a very big challenge. So make sure you also take into account these other aspects in terms of, you know, involving a psychologist or a clinical psychiatrist. You can involve a speech therapist if you think speech is a problem. Or you can have a neurophysician. You can have all these members in loop, especially if it is a neurological geriatric patient. I think I have kind of answered that question. Okay, I will now take the next question, which is by Prachi. Checking the VO2 max or the maximum heart rate. Prachi, this is a very good question. Thanks for bringing this. See, in this webinar, I did not focus on checking the VO2 max for the simple reason because if you remember when I was talking about, you know, checking the health risk of the patients, see, a geriatric patient is definitely going to fall in the category of a moderate health risk. Okay. So when you know somebody already has a lot of underlying health conditions, which is going to tax their body little more. So pushing that patient for a VO2 max test may not really be required. Okay. See, with the VO2 max test, what is it that you're trying to do? You are just trying to check what is the maximum cardiorespiratory endurance that the patient is going to give you. So there are going to be some clinical challenges. If you are running your own, you know, rehabilitation clinic where you are into cardiac or, you know, pulmonary such rehab, what if you're making the patient do this cardiovascular testing for this VO2 max or the maximum heart rate? And somehow while running on the treadmill on a Bruce protocol or on a modified Bruce protocol, let's take that as an example, suddenly your patient, you know, feels unfit or he feels unwell. What if he just collapses? You are not going to be in a position to, you know, do anything for that patient because it is your rehabilitation clinic. Instead, in these patients, if you go for something which is sub-maximal meaning something which is a similar or something which mimics their day-to-day functional lifestyle, such tests will also give you a very correct, you know, status of what is their functional status. So I think in old patients, it is advisable and it is less riskier to, you know, go for functional or suboptimal testing and not these maximal testing. That is what I personally prefer. However, you can have this doubt. For example, when patients, you know, complain of chest pain and all, they do come to a hospital, and in that case, they do undergo a stress test. I'm sure you all have seen any cardiac patient with angina who has, you know, walked on a treadmill, and they have a, you know, an ECG report, a big report which will talk about what was their maximum heart rate. See, that stress test is a very different testing. That is a testing that you are doing to diagnose a particular symptom of that patient. So patient came to the clinic saying, I have, you know, some kind of a vague chest pain, I have some angina like symptoms. So you are diagnosing that patient. So in such a case, doing that diagnostic test is correct, because only when you find that symptom, you can give them the medication. But in our case, as a rehabilitation specialist, what we are trying to do, we are making them run on the treadmill to just see what is their maximum oxygen volume. What are we achieving by, you know, asking them for that oxygen volume? Are you going to change anything? No, instead, the risk is more. So always in such cases, no, you check whether the risk is higher or whether the benefit is higher. Whenever you feel risk is higher in these old patients, just don't do it, because you're going to save somebody's life by not doing it. Okay. So I think I have given a fair, you know, explanation to Prachi and to Mohammed. If there are any other questions. Okay, there's a question by Dr. Kokila. Can you please tell those five stages, like, okay, see, this comes under something called as a trans-theoretical model. If you want, I'll just type it in the chat box. Okay, trans-theoretical model. You can check this approach anywhere on Google Scholar. You will find a lot of articles, okay? It is actually called as the TTM theory. It's a very beautiful theory which talks about five stages. So each of the stages, the very first stage is the I'm just typing it in the chat box, okay? Pre-contemplation, okay? Second stage is the contemplation stage. Third one is the preparation stage. Fourth one is the action stage. Fifth one is the maintenance stage. So any of you who are, you know, interested, please, please go and read this. I'm sure once you start reading this, you know, these TTM theories and how these various stages have an effect on the patient, the way you will approach your patient in your clinic is going to dramatically change. So I will always recommend you all to just go back, read a few things on this and start implementing it. Okay, any other questions? I don't see anything else in the chat box.
If anyone has any question, they can raise their hand so I can unmute them, or they can drop their question in the chat box. I guess there are not more questions.
So, okay, then.
Okay, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Kokila. Thank you so much. See, the purpose of these webinars is just to, you know, orient you with certain newer, you know, emerging concepts in the field of physiotherapy, in the field of rehabilitation, or for that matter, in terms of sports science. So I just try to bring whatever is the latest trend, you know, which is happening. And I will just give you, you know, just like a glimpse of it. And for those of you who are interested, you can just go explore literature. There is a lot of literature that is available. And I'm sure in the future, we'll have more upcoming webinars. So Dr. Bhavesh and Dr. Jeffin are definitely going to organize many more interesting topics for all of you. So you can stay tuned, you can register for all these topics. So I think with this, maybe we can conclude. Yes. Over to you, Dr. Bhavesh.
Thank you so much, Dr. Megha. And thank you so much to all the participants for joining today's webinar. And for e-certificates, you will be getting them within a week. After this webinar. Okay, we can end, Dr. Megha.
Okay, thank you everyone, and have a good Sunday. Take care, stay safe. Bye.